How many are grateful that you know a living, risen Savior named Jesus Christ? How many grateful? Amen. And how many are glad that you're a part of the church? Everybody say the church. Amen. And so we're going to do our best to help us in as we navigate, as we kind of discuss some things that I pray that will help you and bless you. My subject this morning, and I'm just going to let it flow, and I pray that it puts things in your spirit. I encourage you to take notes. I admonish you to jot some things down. I pray that this is something that you could take back to your own teams and, again, help in your own leadership. That's my prayer. That's my hope, that something would take place and shared that would bless you. But my subject this morning is what the best teams do. What the best teams do. And what I mean by that, I want to describe that here in a moment, but what I mean by that is all of us serve on teams, and all of us serve with others, and all of us are part of, I don't know if it's committees or groups or ministries or departments, but I know all of us, this is not a solo act, amen? We get the privilege of doing this together with other great believers, and I realize that sometimes we need some help in these areas. And so what I want to begin sharing with you is the idea that there are our five levels of leadership. I just want to go through this quickly to put your mind of where I'm trying to get you. But there are five levels of leadership. And the first level of leadership is just heart, meaning you have a passion, you have a desire, you're hungry to do something for God. You want to do big things, and you got a lot of desire, but you don't have any official title. Nobody knows who you are. No one even cares who you are, right? You just have a desire to do something for God, and you're wanting to do something that's meaningful, but you don't have a position. Nobody's listening to you. But man, do you have heart. There's a raw passion to do something great for God. And man, you're just hoping for a moment, a day, a time where someone would recognize that you have a heart for God. That's the first level of leadership. You got to have a heart for God. Number two level of leadership is what we would call skills. Like now you've learned to start doing something. Like people, again, you know how to get things done. You have some ability, some talents, some skills that you actually know how to get something done. You finish the job. You know, people recognize, man, you did that really well. That really turned out really great. You have skills. You begin to get confidence. You begin to get this wins under your belt, so to speak. People begin to identify you. Like, this is really, really, something's happening in that life. You can see God really using that individual, elevating, because you learn some skills. People start listening to you. They start coming to you and acknowledging you have something to say. You get invited into some tables and some meetings and discussions. And man, the skills start developing you. That's so important. You learn how to type. You learn how to play. You learn how to sing. You learn how to lead. All these are crucial in developing your leadership skill. You have to have skills. Like I tell people, you either can type or you can't, right? You're either pregnant or you're not. There's just no in between. That's just the bottom line. You got skills to pay the bills or you don't, right? But you need skills. You need skills if you're going to begin to develop your leadership. Well, then there is another level. The third level of leadership is what I would call you actually become the leader. Like you get a job title. You get a responsibility. In the corporate world, you get an office. You get a parking space, right? You get business cards. And that's so important. You start leading, and you got a leadership position. Oh, thank you. Yeah, let me have. Thank you. Perfect. Great. Let me have that. So you got heart. The next thing, you got skills. Okay, you got skills. We talked about skills. I don't know if you can see that back there, but I'm doing my best. And then you actually got, you're the leader. You actually become somebody they go to. You make decisions, right? You start, man, your opinion really puts a lot of weight on the direction. You're the leader. Now, I got to be honest with you. It's good to be the leader, right? It's good to be king. I mean, who doesn't want to be that, right? You got the perks. It's fun. People want you. They seek you out. They want your influence. They want your favor. It's good to be the leader. Now, here's the tragedy about that. Ready? This is why I need you to lean in for a moment.
The tragedy about that is most churches stop right there. If you ever wonder why churches average about 75 in America, why the average church in the world is a small church, is because people grow to this level of leadership. They're the leader. They may even be the pastor. They may even have the job. They may even have the title. But they get stuck right here. There's a bottleneck. No one breathes unless the leader says breathe. No one moves unless the leader says move. The leader says jump and everybody says how high, right? It's good to be the leader. No monies get spent until the leader says so. Nothing happens until the leader says, well, that's what we're doing. And it's good to be the leader. But the problem with that is that we get stuck here. And that's where a lot of leaders are. In fact, if I would be honest, when I get the privilege of talking to leaders and sharing with leaders, I come to this moment and I know in this audience there are people that are right here. You may even be the key leader. You may be the boss. You may be the pastor. And you're the leader. And it's good to be the leader. But what happens after that? How do you grow beyond that? What's the next step above that? Okay, there's where I want to talk, because there are more steps of leadership. The next level of leadership is what I would call a constellation of colleagues. It's great leaders that orbit around one another. They operate around one another. They function well around one another. They're not intimidated by each other's brilliance or anointing or skills. They're not intimidated by others being able to do things better than the key leader. They understand they need brilliant, anointed, gifted, skilled leaders to operate. It's a beautiful thing when you've got amazing, highly gifted, qualified leaders that are orbiting around one another, and there's a seamless respect and honor, and they champion one another. They celebrate one another's great victories and great accomplishments. They're not intimidated because somebody pulls off a great event or does something exceptionally well. They understand we're a constellation of colleagues. You want to know the tragedy? There's very few churches that operate like this. Why? Because we got a lot of intimidated, insecure leaders. The most dangerous leaders I know are insecure leaders. But here's what I also know. No one declares themselves an insecure leader. Like nobody looks in the mirror and says, you're that guy, you're that girl. I'm afraid, I'm intimidated that there's a younger, more fascinating leader that's rising up and going to take my place. No one admits that they're insecure. No one. But the great leaders and the great organizations and the great churches are in this aura and try and work really hard to get into an orbit where there's brilliance and excellence and giftedness and anointing and things that make the church better, and they operate around one another. It's amazing. That's exactly like our solar system. You got 9 planets, I think 8 now. We kicked out Pluto. So we got 8 planets now, right, orbiting around one another. They don't collide. They don't cause havoc for one another. It's a beautiful thing when there's an orbiting of great, brilliant, fantastic leaders. And this is where I've spent most of my leadership life now, trying to understand, unpackage, time to learn what causes this. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me just finish the 5 levels of leadership, because there's one more level. And this is the best level. And that's what I would call the God level. It's where God takes a church, an individual, a ministry, and blesses it, and it just blossoms. It just explodes. It just grows. And when you ask them, like, man, what happened? What was the secret sauce? Like, what did you do that caused you to take that major step and grow? And they got to be honest, say, I don't know. We just worked hard and we just kept our head down. We just prayed and believed, and God just took this church and took this ministry and took this life. And all of a sudden, man, it's beyond what we've ever imagined or dreamed. Like, there's a possibility that what you lead has to outgrow your skills. There's a possibility, the thing that God's called you to champion has to outgrow your ability. I tell people, Goodlettsville outgrew my skill set a long time ago. They outgrew it a long time ago. But where I want to capture your attention and where I want you to lean in, where I hope that I can help some leader today, is I want to talk about this right here, that constellation of colleagues. And that's exactly what I mean by what the best teams do. What do they do? What does that look like? What are the behaviors? What are the values? What do they do that is so helpful that begins to see a blossom of ministries? Here's what I know. If we don't get this right, damage happens in the kingdom of God. People get frustrated. People walk away from their skills and their anointing and their calling because they wonder if there's any room for them. Can I get an amen and a roll me? Again, either one will work, okay? A good Baptist nod would work too. We're just going to hear together, right? We're all friends. Let's just lean in and give a group hug, right? Brother Zuniga's for you. I'm just trying to teach. I don't know you. I don't know your situation. I'm just telling you what I know. So I want to dive into this, and I want you to learn from this, and I want you to decipher, where are you in this? Because there are several keys, and I'm going to give them to you one at a time, of what this level of leaders do. Because what I want you to understand, I remember I was in a conference, and they were interviewing T.D. Jakes. And anybody know T.D. Jakes? That man's a preacher, right? Bless the name of the Lord. He's not only a preacher. I mean, he's a writer. He's a songwriter, producer. He's a corporate executive. I mean, like his resume is thick, right? So they were interviewing T.D. Jakes and just asking, like, man, how do you do all that you do? Like, you're preaching amazing messages, and man, you're writing books, and you're doing podcasts, and you're doing television shows, and you're doing this, and you're doing that. And how do you do that? And I'll never forget what he said. He said this. He said, there are times that you need leaders, and then there are times that you need better leaders. Man, when he said that, I thought, good God, that is so true. Like, sometimes you just need a warm body to show up, right? Like, I don't even care if you brush your teeth. Just show up. Just get there. Like, we just need somebody to stand there. I don't even care if you're yawning. Just be there, right? Sometimes you need just somebody. But if you're ever going to scale, and if you're ever going to achieve your redemptive potential, if you're ever going to maximize what God wants to do through you, you have to understand there are times you need better leaders. Men and women that give their best to the kingdom of God. Like, God did not save you and give you your skills and talents for you to grow in the corporate sector. Like, he didn't just bless you so you would make a paycheck. God blessed you with your skills to make a living, but he also blessed you with those skill sets to make damage to the kingdom of darkness for his glorious kingdom. Now, I don't know about you, but I can run an aisle just on that right there. Because it's true. God did not save you and give you your skills, ability, and talent so you'd put $5 in your pocket. He created you, hardwired you, put inside the cavity of your chest callings and passions and things that only he and his kingdom can satisfy. Because sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, you need better leaders. Navy SEALs, which is a great military team in the U.S. Navy, and one of their commanders was doing a speech, and he was talking to leaders and trying to motivate them. And he said this. He said, bad teams work against each other. Bad teams work against each other. Good teams work with each other. But elite teams work for each other. Like, there's a difference. Are we just getting along? Are we being kind to one another? Or are we actually doing what it takes to work for one another? There's where I want to take you on the journey. So if you're ready, number one, the best teams have winning players, not just good players. When we're determining the top two factors of people that look like they're going to succeed, they look like they're going to succeed, but they actually fail, okay? They look like they're winners, but they're actually losers. The top two things that determine those that look like they're winners but they're actually losers are these things. Number one, they have poor relational skills. They don't play well in the sandbox with others. They don't know how to get along. They don't know how to be kind to one another. They don't play well. They're stingy with their toys and they're stingy with their ideas. They always have to be the one that wins. Their ideas are only the ones that they will champion and support. If it's not their idea, they're going to find a way to undermine someone else's idea. Here's what I can tell you, ladies and gentlemen. You can't control if people like you. Like, I can give you $1,000 and hopefully that you like me, but I can't control if you like me. What I can control is being likable, right? What I can control is being kind and respectful and caring. I can control that. I can't control whether you like me or not, but one thing that leaders can control is if they're likable. Remember, at the end of the day, it's not what you say or do, it's how you make people feel that matters the most. Your attitude. Look, this is why I tell our leaders, lean in for a second. This is why I tell our leaders, every interaction you have, I don't care if it's in the bathroom, I don't care if it's at the drinking faucet, I don't care if it's during tea. Is that what we do, tea, right? I don't care if it's doing tea. Every interaction you have, you're either polishing the brand or you're dinging the brand. Every interaction you have, you're either polishing the brand or you're dinging the brand. Because if you're nice to pastor, but you're mean to the waiter, you're not a nice person. I thought I'd get about two jump up and down and say amen to that. This is a hard crowd this morning. I'm telling you, I got my work cut out. Right? If you're nice to your leaders, but you're rude to your fellow member, you're not a nice person. We should offer respect and kindness to every individual we interact with. Because every interaction, you're either polishing the brand or dinging the brand. And better leaders understand that. The next thing that they say that is the determining factors that people that look like they're winners but they're actually losers is the inability to adapt. They have a hard time having mid-course corrections. In the day and hour we live in, you want to know what a superpower is? A superpower in today's leadership culture is being flexible. Knowing how to know shift and change and things you did not expect and things that rise that you did not account for, but you're not thrown and you're not discouraged because it didn't go as scheduled or planned. You recognize that's life and you do the best you can and you make the correction and you keep moving forward. Like some people fall apart when something gets off course. In the day and hour we live in, you want to know those churches that survived COVID? You want to know those that thrived during COVID? They didn't just survive, they thrived. You know how they did it? They adapted. They took what was given to them and they did the best they could and God blessed that and they kept moving forward. Well, here's the good news, the two determining factors of successful people. We're talking about these leaders that actually make a difference. The two determining factors of successful people is the ability to adapt. They're experts in mid-course correction. They're flexible. They're open to change. They know that other ideas can come into the conversation and maybe even late in the hour. But they realize that we have to be flexible and open to other people and other insight and new information and new ideas and new technology and things. Like the challenge I'm having right now is I ask myself the question, where am I innovating and where am I adapting and where am I playing at the fringe end of my leadership capacity? How am I adapting to things that I'm not accustomed to? Because here's what happens. When it's not what we're accustomed to, we get mad. There's a lot of leaders that are getting mad at the culture, mad at society. It's like we expect sinners to act like Christians when sinners are supposed to act like sinners. And we get mad because they act like sinners. I'm going to tell you what gets me mad is when believers act like sinners. Amen? But that's a whole different story. But the Luami, you have to clean that up, okay? But they can make adaptions and they can make changes. But the next thing they have that they are actually successful and what makes them so powerful on the team is they have strong, strong relational skills. You may call it EQ, emotional quotient. They understand how they make people feel. They own their body language. Like when you walk in the room, when you walk into the meeting, hear me, when you walk into the room, does the room lighten up or does it tighten up? Right? Like when you know that individual, I don't know who their name is on their team, but they walk in and you ask, what kind of mood are they in today? Like, is this going to be a good day? Are we dealing with some issues today, right? Like, you have to sometimes walk around on eggshells, right? Because you don't want to offend anybody. Like, you can tell by their facial expression, man, they've had a bad morning, maybe a bad life. I don't know. But, man, it's not good today. Right? Like, are you that temperamental that you can't know how you make people feel? You feel like you have the right to walk into a church service, a meeting, a discussion with a bad attitude, with like a look on your face that you got punched in the nose? Or do you realize, you know what, there are a lot of times I walk onto that campus and things are not well. There's battles that are going on, but my face will never show it. I'm going to smile. I'm going to, man, Brother Harvey, how you doing, buddy? Good to see you. Man, how you doing? So good to see you. Lord bless you. Man, you doing all right? And I could be going through hell on the inside or things that I'm dealing with. But I realize my body language, my EQ really sets the stage. We don't need a pastor that walks under the platform and he's down and discouraged and broken and he wonders he's going to make it. Like, I'm worried about Jesus. You know what we need? People that understand, no, this is hard work. But I'm going to make it anyway, and God's on my side, and somehow, some way, he's going to see me through this. I get weary about people that can have bad attitudes and show up, and they don't understand their EQ. If I had a magic wand, whoop, 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 boom. If I was going to bless you with something, I would bless you with the idea and the giftedness of self-awareness. You know how you're responding. You know how you are engaging. You know what you're projecting. You know the spirit that you are projecting. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not just for some. The church of the living God needs brilliant, fantastic, aware leaders of how we come across, the way we present ourselves. Does it matter? Does it matter? Like, I wonder, does anybody smile anymore? Just put a smile on your face. Just make me feel better. We did that. Just like Brother Howe used to tell us. He said, I'm going to take an offering today. Ready? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to take an offering. He says, I want a smile offering. Give me a smile offering. Right? Leaders, this is what it takes. If you're going to be at this level of leading, nobody wants to be around a rude, grouchy leader. Nobody wants to be around a temperamental leader. Nobody wants to be around an insecure leader. And I'm just telling you, we don't teach this in school. We rarely learn this in family dynamics. And leaders understand you have to educate yourself. Let me just say it right. You got to educate yourself, okay? Because it doesn't come natural. That's why you're here at Turning Point, and that's why this matters. Because if we take this one attitude and we go back to our churches, there will be better Sunday school staff and better usher teams and better first impression people and better church services, right? And we don't have the musicians here and all the singers, so I can talk about them. Right? But some of them people need Jesus, I'm telling you right now. Right? They think they're a God's gift to man, and they think, like, man, they're the cat's meow. No, you need to repent. That's what you need. Come and sing and give us your talent, but walk off that stage and not greet anybody, not shake anybody's hand, not, hey, how are you? Glad to see you. Like, we have a mindset in our church. Here's our mindset. Ready? I'm branding this. I'm putting it in people's spirits. If I believed in tattoo, I'd be tattooing on them. It's this, right? The idea is this. There you are. There you are. Because most people come to church, here I am. I made it after 2 months of missing. Aren't you glad to see me? Isn't it a great day I'm here? Right? Not leaders. Leaders don't come, here I am. Leaders come, there you are. We've been waiting for you. It's great to see you. How you been? Right? Like, hey, let me ask, before you remind people about the problems and what they didn't do right, like you didn't show up, you didn't do this right, why don't you, before you correct them, why don't you ask them, hey, how are you doing? You have no idea the dynamics that they've been facing. Their family challenges, the job, the health. You don't know the doctor report. You don't know what their kid just told them. And we look at the fruit of their lives and we judge them. But we don't know the inside game, because there are people in this room right now that you're facing some challenges and some turmoils, and you're trying to get it right. And somebody needs to just say, hey, how are you? And you know what would be great? If your leaders would do that. So when I sit with my leaders, before I give the list of things that I need them to do, before I tell them where I wish they'd get better at, my first question to them is, how are you? Tell me something. How's things going? Because people want to feel like they're cared for, not just used. The church should be the healthiest volunteer organization in the world, because we care for one another and we care for our volunteers, and we're concerned about not what they do, not the class they teach. We care about them. We care about their life and their well-being and where God is doing in their life. And somebody say amen. Man, I don't even know if I can go on. This is already too thick in here, ladies and gentlemen. I'm just starting, okay? But I'm telling you, this is the problem. This is the issue. Because I'm telling you, we get stuck here. We like being the leader. We like being the boss. But we don't really do what it takes to grow an organization that lets others fly and soar and live and breathe and experience all that God has for them. Would you throw your hands up in the air right now and say, God, help us in the name of Jesus. Help us in the name of Jesus. Help us, oh God, to shift our mindset. Come on, pray it. You're not done yet, God. I don't want to learn this. I want to lean into this. I don't want to know this. I want my behavior, my mindset, my spirit to shift in the Holy Ghost. Somebody shout amen. Number two. I'm just on number two, ladies and gentlemen. Number two. Ready? The best teams are intentional of knowing one another. The best teams are intentional on knowing one another. And this takes time, spending time together, spending time regularly, that you get to know the people that are working with you. You spend time knowing them. I use this phrase in our church, knowing leads to loving. The more I know about you, the more I know about your journey and your story and what God's done for you, the more I learn to love you. If I put this mic and I pass this mic around and started hearing your testimonies of what God brought you through, you would be amazed what God has delivered and brought men and women in this room through. They've been raped, abused, they've been neglected, divorced, they've been sick, they've been nigh to death, and they're here this morning. And when I know that about you, I celebrate the good God of glory that has blessed and healed and delivered. Some of you are alcoholics and drug addicts, and some of you are in the world, but today you're living for the kingdom of God. The problem is we don't lean into this. Can I just tell you, in the corporate executive world, they literally spend thousands and dozens and tens of thousands of dollars trying to get this idea of knowing. Our corporate executives, our C-suite, they would lean in and try to know one another, because there's an important aspect of us feeling close and feeling like family, feeling like we belong. But we don't do this. So we've done a little exercises, and we've tried to do something. I'll give you an example here, okay? I'll give you an example. So we'll get our leaders, and we'll gather them around, and we'll put all of their name in a cup, okay? We'll put all their names in a cup. And in a meeting, we'll randomly pull out one of their names. I got to be honest with you. Some of our leaders get really terrified when I get the cup out and pull the name, like, please don't call me. Please don't pick my name. Jesus, Lord, right now in the name of Jesus. Okay? So I need somebody to help me right now. Can I just get one volunteer real quick? Just any volunteers? Can you join me, please, all the way in front of the back? What's your name? Nathan? Come on, Nathan. Give Nathan a good hand. Come on, Brother Nathan. How are you, buddy? You enjoying Turning Point? Huh? Where are you from, Nathan?
I'm from Queensland.
Queensland?
Yeah.
Like, where's that?
Up north.
Okay. And we're down south?
Yeah.
Okay. I know where I'm at now. That's a good thing, okay? Nathan, it's been a blessing to see God bless you.
Thank you.
And you and I have talked before this, so
yeah.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Would you sit down right here?
Yeah,
okay. So Nathan, do they have the lottery here? Like, do they have lottery? Like, okay. So Nathan, I know you don't play the lottery, so let's just go back and pretend, okay? If you won the lottery, okay, like you won the lottery, Nathan, like, where would you go on vacation? If you could go anywhere on vacation, where would you go on vacation?
Probably Canada, to be honest.
Canada?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Scenery.
What
yeah. Park? I don't know yet. I'm been.
The Rockies, like the middle of the Rocky Canadian Rockies. Whew, Lord Jesus. Beautiful, okay? If you won the lottery, like, what is the first thing you would do with the money?
Buy a house.
Okay. Well, that sounds logical. You know, what? Just so you know, Nathan, when I've asked these people to our church, they say, we're going to pay off the church. So I'm just going to encourage you to pay off the church, okay? Yeah, yes. How many would like to see Nathan pay off the church, right? Like, I mean, like, come on, Jesus. Musicians come. Like, this is about to get over. Right? So you, if you could drive, like, you could buy any car. Because, I mean, you got money now, you know? Okay, so.
R35 for sure. What? Nissan Skyline.
Okay. R35. I don't even know what that is, but man, I'm sure that's a fast and fancy car, okay? All right. Nathan, again, say what you feel comfortable, okay? But tell me something that was very challenging in your life before you were 18 years old.
In what regard?
Whatever you feel comfortable.
Became like drug addicted.
How old were you?
16.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, how many of you knew that about Nathan? I see one person in the back. Okay. Nathan, I really appreciate that you're sharing that. We don't know what Nathan had to go through or been through or faced or still faces because of that reality. But you know what it makes me want to do? God's got you, Nathan. You're going to be okay. Stay faithful. I'm telling you, God. All right? Thank you. What I'm telling you is people don't have an opportunity to share their stories. They don't have an opportunity to learn from one another's battles because there could be somebody here that's battling drugs. And when they hear Nathan, hey, you know what? Man, God is helping me. I'm here at church. He could be dead, but he's here at church. It brings strength to the body of Christ, right? This is what I mean. This is what I mean by learning to lean in and to know one another. In our team, we have to take time. Like, if all you're worried about is what are we going to do for Easter and what are we going to do for this coming Sunday, and we got a nursery problem because nobody wants to babysit those brat kids, and so we got a nursery problem, right? But we don't take time to lean in, because the great teams, ladies and gentlemen, those that orbit one another, they know and understand one another. And they spend time leaning in. And here's the deal. The corporate world does better than us as a church. But I'm telling you, those teams and those churches and organizations that really begin to ascend and really begin to work at a level that they can only dream of, it's because the leaders are together. So important. Now, I could be honest with you. God has to help us in these things. God has to give us confidence in these things. Number three, the best teams build on the foundation of trust. The best teams build on a foundation of trust. The challenge is this, that no team can survive or do its best when there is no room for honesty. Okay? Like, we get in groups and we get in meetings, but we really can't share our true thoughts or feelings. Now, I'm stepping in some things here, okay? I'm just being honest. On Monday, I'm getting on the plane. I'm going home. I'm going to leave all the mess to y'all, okay? I'm just going to steer the pot, right? Okay? But I realize, and I've been doing this a long time, and I know how difficult this is, and I know how challenging this is. But there has been season on our senior leadership team. We've brought consultants in and said, I want you to survey. I want you to survey me as a pastor. Like, where can I get better? Like, I need you to help me because I don't see my blind spots. I don't see my weaknesses as clear as my leaders see my weaknesses. And one of the things that came in this survey with this consultant that came in is there is an undercurrent of trust issues on this team. Or we didn't trust one another, and we didn't trust each other's motives or emotions or true feelings or thought. And it began to take a toll on the team and ideas and how we function. And we began to have conversations. And I got to be honest with you. The last 2 or 3 years have been some of the toughest leadership times of Julie's and I's ministry. When we've had to have honest conversations with key leaders, people that have really helped the church, that have significant influence, and say, listen, you're no longer able to keep moving with us. There are some behavior. There's some attitude. There's something going on in the spirit that you no longer. And having that hard, honest conversation is a very tough job. I'm here to tell you that some of you are one tough conversation away from a breakthrough in your leadership team. And it's hard. So this is what I ask leaders. When's the last time you exercised your leadership muscle? Like, when's the last time you did a tough decision? Like, I describe it like this, okay? That you know you're going to have a conversation with somebody, and it's not all going to be well. 80% of that conversation is going to be just, hi, how are you? And getting the platitudes and the niceties out of the way, and you're going to get into some subject matter. That's about 80% of the conversation. There's going to be about 15% of that conversation that's going to be really, 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 really tough. You're going to get a little queasy, and you're going to get a little bit shy. You're going to get emotional. Your heart's going to start racing. You're going to have to say some tough things, okay? Things that you know that needs to be said, but you don't want to say it. But ladies and gentlemen, there's going to be about 5% of that conversation. It's like getting a grenade and you pull the pin, and you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know if they're going to leave the church. You don't know if they're going to get up. You don't know what's going to happen. But great leaders pull the pin. I've been there. I'm going to tell you, where the people that I had to have a tough conversation no longer go to our church, no longer come to our church, and see that ripple effect even in their children after they've been with us for 15 years, a long time. But something began to take place in the spirit or in their mind that began to cause a division, and they begin to have conversations on the side with others and people, and those leaders would come to me and say, Pastor, I just need you to know this. This is what's going on. And when I sit down with those leaders and being honest with them in the most loving way, not mad, not mean, not trying to be vindictive, not trying to get back, but in a most loving way and saying, I no longer need you to serve on the senior leadership team. Very tough. You want to know why? You want to know what keeps leaders up at night? The thing that keeps leaders up at night is people problems. Want to know why leaders quit? Want to know why leaders back away? It's because people issues rise up. It does take some strength, and it does take some handrails how to lead people in this. That's why trust is so important. So let's get into this. How do you build trust? Like, what does that look like? How do you make sure trust, I can say trust, and you have an idea what that is, and I have an idea what that is, but how do we actually build trust? Well, let me give you some hand rules on how to build trust. We build trust by demonstrating respect. Demonstrating respect. Like, we value people's thoughts and opinions. We demonstrate respect by the way we talk to one another, the tone of voice we address one another. There are sometimes that you need to be careful how you come across, because sometimes you may not come across like you think you're coming across. Right? Demonstrate respect. You greet one another. You look at one another in the eye. You make sure that, hey, listen, I'm praying for you. I value you. You're demonstrating respect. I don't want my teammates to just demonstrate respect to me and my wife. I want them to demonstrate respect for every member on our team. I want them to value one another, respect one another. Number two way of how you build trust is you create transparency. There's no hidden agenda. I'm not trying to do something without you knowing what I'm trying to do. There's a transparency. I'm here because I want to serve and I want to do my best. And when we have a nursery problem, you remember the bratty kids? When we have a nursery problem, we all have a nursery problem. When there's something going on in the church, that's not just the youth pastor's problem. That's all of our problem. There's a transparency here. The best way to do this is to get people to get vulnerable and to admit their weaknesses. This is awesome. When you can, as a leader, say, you know what? I'm going to tell you my weakness, okay? Here's my weakness, all right? And it took me years to get this. Like, this is therapy for me, right, okay? Because it's taken me decades to get to where I need to tell you, okay? Like, people would say this, and I would fight it, and I would refute it, and I would go against it. But this is my weakness. I have to be conscious of this, as there are times that I let problems go longer because I just don't want to deal with them. Where's the musicians? I need a musician to come. They're right? That's my weakness. When there's leaders say, you need to step into that. You need to address that. You need to confront that. But because I love people, because I don't want anything bad to happen to the church, because I'm a wimp sometimes, because I don't have the emotional strength sometimes. Come on, ladies and gentlemen, right? Right? Like, have you ever had to kick somebody out of church? No? That's a tough job for a pastor. But I've actually had to do that to a family that's been in that church for generations and look at this individual and say, you no longer can come to this church, only for funerals and weddings can you step on this property. That is a tough conversation. That's a hard conversation. But that's my weaknesses. That's my weakness. What our leaders want me to do is when I become vulnerable and when I let them know, when I share where I'm struggling, it allows them to pull their armor down and share what they're going through as well. Here's another way how we build trust is we own our mistakes or we right wrongs. We right wrongs. You own our mistakes. There's not a leader I know that does everything perfect and well and right all the time. Can I just get some honest people in the house and say amen? Like, how many will be honest with me and say, I've blown it as a leader at times. Come on, just own it. You're in the house of God. God will strike you dead. I'm just telling you. Okay? Right? And it's comforting when you as a leader gets up and say, you know what? I didn't handle that situation right. I didn't say that in the right way. You don't lose credibility. You don't lose position in people's mind. Actually, people respect you when they understand when you know something's off. You're not perfect. Neither do people expect you to be perfect. But what they do expect us to be is real and honest. Another thing that we do to grow trust is show loyalty. And this is how we show loyalty, okay? Like, have you ever got a text or an email and you read it and you said something like this, like why did they say that? Like, why did they have to come across with that attitude? Like, I tell people, when you read a text from me, the first thing you do when you read a text from me is put a smile on your face. And then you read the text because that's how I sent it. Now, thank God for emojis now where you can put a little laughing, crying, and all this kind of stuff to help that, right? That's why they're invented, so you get the right flavor of how they're coming across, right? But what leaders do is we extend the most generous interpretation possible to the intentions, words, and actions of others. We extend the best interpretation. Like, I believe in that person. They're good people. They're for us. They're on our side. They care about us. Let me show you a trick that we have on our team. And so there are times that we need to have a conversation. Like, we'll talk about Sunday's message or Sunday service and the announcement, the singing, the song. And we're going to talk about Sunday school or first impressions, whatever the subject is. We're going to unpackage Sunday. And sometimes there are things that happen on Sunday that we don't like, okay? Somebody was given a mic and they were singing and they couldn't sing. Like, those people need to be shot, right? Like, do something else, okay? Because that mic is not your friend, right? Like, I know you sing in the mirror and karaoke, but not here, okay? Yeah, you're anointed for your bedroom, not the platform, okay? Right? Come on, I feel the Holy Ghost in that, right? All right? You got to be honest, right? So sometimes you got to say tough stuff that you want them to understand. And so we have this, we got it from somewhere else. I don't remember where we got it. But we'll do something like this. We'll say, hey, can you give me an umbrella of mercy? We literally do this. Everybody do this. Can you? Like, that's literally what we do. Like, can you give me an umbrella of mercy? When a team leader says, hey, can I just have an umbrella of mercy? It's like everybody in the room just sits back in the chair. Oh, yeah, say whatever you want to do. I mean, you just have at it. I mean, vomit on us. We're good, right? Because we know they're trying to say it in the best way possible. We know when they say that, signal that way, they're going to try to say it. They're not trying to be offensive or hurt somebody's feeling. They're just trying to be honest. See, before that, we didn't know how to say something that's tough, and maybe it's about somebody's family member or friend or kid or something. We didn't know how to say it in a way that they would receive it in the best possible way. But now that we have a tool like, hey, give me an umbrella of mercy, we understand they're trying their very best to say something that's a little challenging, a little difficult, and we need to give them room to say that. Can I tell you, be honest? The reason we get stuck in churches, and I can be accused of this as well, is because church at sometimes we're too nice. We're too nice. We don't want to have that tough conversation. We don't want to make that tough call. We're too nice. Okay, it's 10:30. I want you to stand. And Brother Harvey, if you want to come and take it, but I can dismiss him if you. But we're going to pause right there. Now, ladies and gentlemen, there's several more when we get back.